But I'm on the road most of the time because we're working with individuals just like yourselves, with elected officials, ministries, political figures, candidates, on how to best think about using Facebook in order to connect with your constituents. And what we wanted to do today was to walk you through some of the best practices that we've seen from other ministries around the world on how they are best using our platform, and also provide you some examples, and then we'll do some Q&A. I also have colleagues of mine from our media team here who, after our coffee break, will be talking to you about how you can really take what I'm going to be talking about for helping you to think about developing content and how you can really boost that to make sure that you're reaching all of the people that you need to in a targeted way. The governments and ministries that we work with that tend to do Facebook the best have found a way to really complement what they do on the non-paid or the organic side, as well as thinking about on the paid side to how you can most effectively use your dollars to make sure that you're getting your messages out. Really quickly, I wanted to first talk about some numbers about where Facebook is right now. Globally, we have over 1.4 billion monthly active users on our platform. A monthly active user is somebody who's logged into Facebook at least once in the last 30 days. We also have Instagram as part of the Facebook family. I have somebody on my team, John, whose only job is to work with elected officials and politicians and governments on how to best think about using Instagram. I won't be talking about much about Instagram today, but do know it's a very different platform. The content that works on it is very different, and we're always happy to answer any questions that you might have on how to use Instagram. And then the other number I just want to point out is 4 billion. Every single day on our platform, we have 4 billion video views. Video views are becoming an increasingly important piece of content that people can upload directly to Facebook, and it's getting a lot of engagement and a lot of viewer views by people who are using our platform. In Brazil, we have 94 million monthly active users, and 81 million of those are mobile. We're a mobile-first company. Everything we build is for a mobile device first. And I really recommend that you think about being a mobile first office as well. Anything that you put up on Facebook should be able to be seen and easily read if you are using Facebook as on a desktop computer or if you are using it on your mobile phone. Oftentimes I see people with really great infographics or really great images, but it has a lot of text on it, and that's really hard to read on the phone. And so what we recommend is that you try to think through and just make sure your content is working for both platforms. The other power of Facebook is really just how much we see people trusting information that they're getting from their friends and family. So the more that you can get your fans to be engaging with and sharing your content, the better off it is. Nielsen did a study back in 2012 that showed that 47% of people trust news and information they get from traditional media, whereas 92% trust information that they're getting from their friends and family. So the more that you can encourage engagement on your posts, encourage people to share it, the more effective you will be. Okay, they really don't want you to see that slide. Well, let me just talk about it, and then we'll go into this part. I just really wanted to say on that other slide is that, and I don't know if they in the back can move it back one, but when you're thinking about your Facebook pages, first you want to make sure that you have a page name and URL that can stand the test of time. You want it to just be the name of your ministry. If you're doing one for your minister, just his or her name. That's very important. Next, you want to make sure that you can set the appropriate administrator roles for everybody who's an admin on your page. Because you want to make sure that maybe some people have full permissions, and others might just have the option to only post content, and others might only have the option in which to moderate comments. Then we recommend that you have a comments policy on your page. What that is you want to be transparent with your fans about when it is that you'll delete comments and when it is that you will ban somebody from commenting on your page. Nobody expects you to be able to let every internet troll be on your page just constantly posting the same thing over and over again. Nobody wants you to allow swear words or people to just say anything that they want. So if you're transparent and you have that comments policy up on your site, you are able to then have something that you can point to for when you do ban or delete somebody. And then I do recommend that you use our profanity and our moderation block list filters. The profanity filter allows you to prevent swear words from appearing on your site. And the way the moderation block list works is that you can put a certain word in that block list. And then when somebody tries to comment using that word, they will see it, their friends will see it, you will see it as an administrator, but nobody else will. It can be a very powerful tool to help if you're getting a group of people posting the same thing over and over and over again. Now on to securing your accounts. Oops. Can we go back one more? There we go, thank you. I really wanted to talk about making sure you have your account secure. I get a lot of questions from people about how do we make sure our page doesn't get hacked. And what you want to make sure is that, remember, is that pages don't get hacked. It's the profiles of the administrators that get hacked, and then they get access to the page. So for any of you who are an administrator on a Facebook profile, there's a couple of things you want to make sure that you do. First, you want to make sure that you have a strong password. Then you want to make sure you have our login approvals and notifications turned on. What this will do is that if anybody tries to log into your Facebook account from an unknown device or an unknown location, we will then send you a text message with a 6-digit code that you need to use in order to log in. And then also make sure that you have your email account also secured. Another way that I see people losing access to their profiles is that they lose access to their email account and then they do a forgotten password reset. If you turn these security settings on, you should be very well set to make sure that you are most secure and people will not hack your page. Should anything happen, we do have a site you can go to, facebook.com/hacked, where you can try to regain access to your profile, but please don't hesitate to reach out to us immediately. Bruno and Natalie are here in Brasilia, and we have teams of people around the world that can immediately help secure your page and help you to regain access. Before I go into some of the content best practices, I wanted to talk a little bit about how our newsfeed algorithm works. We get a lot of questions about why it is that we even have our newsfeed algorithm. And what we find is that on average, there's about 1,500 pieces of content that any individual could be shown on one day. We find we have to curate about 300 of those. So how do we do that? This is all based on the user. We want to make sure the user is seeing content that they want to engage with, and it's the content that they want to see. So you're competing up against all of the pictures from their friends and family and other pages that they follow. There's a lot of different factors that we take into account with our newsfeed algorithm, but there are five that I think you should keep in mind when you're coming up with your content strategy. The first thing that we look at every time you post something up on Facebook is we look at how recently has that person engaged with your page. And that's usually over the last couple of days. So we recommend that you try to post at least once a day, or at bare minimum, 5 out of 7 days a week. Because many people are visiting Facebook every single day, and if they're not engaging with your content, they're going to be engaging with somebody else's. Then we look at how much engagement overall the post is getting. And that is also looks at how many of their friends and family are engaging on that post. Then we look at your page. Does your page have a history of putting up content that we know people like to engage with? Finally, we look at two more things. We look at the type of content. Some people really like to click on photos. Some people like to click on videos. Some people like to click on links. We want to make sure we're showing them the content we know they like to engage with. And so it's important for you to really mix up the types of content that you're putting up on Facebook. You shouldn't just be putting up photos. You shouldn't just be putting up videos. So to give you an example, if you are announcing something and you want to make sure that this gets out to everybody, to the people on Facebook who are following you, rather than just doing one post, what you might think about doing is a series of four. Your first post might be a picture of your minister in their office reviewing a speech before they go out to deliver it. Then the next post might be a short video clip from that minister's speech and the announcement. After that, you might post a news article link or a link to your website with more information. And then perhaps later on that day or a few days later, you do what we call as a face-to-face, and you answer questions from your fans about that initiative. And I'll talk more about both videos and face-to-faces. And then finally, we look at, are you talking about a topic that a lot of other people are talking about on Facebook? You may have noticed that posts about holidays do really well. Posts about last year, the World Cup, did very, very well. All of that was really because we saw a lot of people talking about that on Facebook. The elections here were huge. It was our third biggest event globally on Facebook, behind only the World Cup and the Ebola crisis. And so you want to take a look at what's trending on Facebook and also what's being talked about in the news. And if it's appropriate, post about it on your Facebook page. So to give you one quick example of what these face-to-faces are, these are two that were done recently in, both were in Europe. So the first one on my left is the digital minister for the European Commission, Frans Timmermans. This was his second Q&A he did face-to-face that he did last week. And what he does, and the other one on the right is the German foreign ministry doing one of these face-to-faces. And how this works is they do a post on their page inviting people to submit questions in the comment section, as you can see here on the right, and then they just use the reply feature underneath each comment in order to answer it. These face-to-faces are a really great way to be able to answer a lot of questions at scale. And when you put a time limit to it and let people know that you only have 30 minutes, even 15 minutes is okay. Nobody expects you to be able to answer every single question. Some ministries, Mr. Timmermans now does these about once a month. The German Foreign Ministry doesn't have a regular schedule, but they try to do them when the situations permit. The other ways that we see Facebook being used quite a bit is one way is really breaking news. The White House has really started to do this. Most recently, I was just reading this morning, they've done this with the Iran deal that they're working on. But with the State of the Union, what the White House did differently this year is that traditionally the State of the Union is a very secretive speech. You don't know what's going to be talked about in it until he actually delivers it in front of Congress. But what the White House decided to do differently this year was that the week leading up to the speech, he did a series of videos on Facebook announcing some of the initiatives that he would be talking about in front of Congress. And what this did was it allowed him to really frame the press story. It allowed him and the White House to get their full statement, their full message out in front of the public. The press still covered it. This is a USA Today story. The press still covered it, but they still had their full side of the story out there, and they were pretty much able to circumvent the media and not require the media's media to tell their story. And what we saw is that we had nearly as many people watch video clips from the State of the Union on Facebook this year than who watched it on TV. We are increasingly seeing more and more people getting their news and information by going to Facebook than to any other method. In fact, in the US, there was a study that came out last week from Pew Internet that shows that 30% of people who are on Facebook are getting most of their political news through the platform and engaging with it. The other thing to remember when you're doing your postings, and this is what's on the right-hand side, is making sure that you're tagging other organizations, other ministries, other public officials when you are doing posts that include them. So this is an example of the Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi when he visited Canada on a state visit. And he tagged Stephen Harper, which you can see it's highlighted in blue. What tagging does is that what it helps to do is we will show them Mr. Harper's fans, potentially show them this post by Mr. Modi, even though they're not a fan of Mr. Modi, because we know it's about a topic that they're already interested in. Tagging other organizations, pages, and public figures isn't necessarily going to gain you thousands of new fans, though in Prime Minister Harper's case, this did happen because Mr. Modi has 29 million fans on Facebook. But it will help you to gain some new ones. It helps you to get in front of new audiences. And with Facebook, for the most part, it's the little things that you do to help increase your number of fans and who you're getting in front of that can really add up to success over a long period of time. There we go. Behind the scenes pictures continue to do really well on the site. This picture on the left is one of my favorite of John Kerry doing a selfie with an elephant in Nairobi. And then the one on the right is Narendra Modi doing a selfie with Premier Li of China. These types of images are ones that people won't get in the traditional press. They're not the pictures of people just doing handshakes. They're not a picture of their boss just up on a podium giving a speech. These are the behind the scenes images that people would never otherwise get to experience. And so for your offices, because I know this could be incredibly hard, how do we make a ministry exciting? How do we figure out what behind the scenes pictures do we do? You don't have to do this every single day, but one thing we worked with on Mr. Modi's team was looking at his schedule and trying to figure out where there might there be opportunities that they can take some of these photos. And what we encouraged them to do was to just start taking photos and video, even if they don't end up using it, just to get used to figuring out what works best for their schedules, what works best for the Prime Minister. And so I would make the same recommendation to you. Think about what might work and what might not work for your ministry, but then just go ahead and try it. You don't have to put the pictures or videos that you're taking up on Facebook, but the more that you practice with it, the more you'll figure out what your own voice is and what you're willing to do. You could even think about doing things. I've seen some ministries will they will do a video tour of the ministry. They might share the minister's office, a picture of their desk, and share if there's something interesting on it, pictures of their family, things from places they've traveled. Anything like that can all be things that you might potentially put up on your Facebook page to just give fans a glimpse of what it's like to be in the ministry or to be in your government agency. I mentioned video and how important video is. If you haven't tried to do so already, I highly recommend that you post video directly to Facebook now. Still post it to YouTube, that's still important, but don't post the YouTube link on your Facebook page anymore. Because what we are seeing is Facebook is getting a lot more views than YouTube is. And when you think about the two different platforms, we have different purposes too in how people are trying to find video. Facebook is a place where video is discovered. People don't necessarily go to Facebook knowing that they're going to find this great video. Whereas if you go to YouTube, you usually have an intention of something that you're going to search for. So it's important that you use both platforms. These are two examples that I wanted to call out of different types of video that work well, because your video in Facebook doesn't have to be highly produced. Some of the best video comes from a mobile phone. This one on the left is another one from Mr. Modi, where they were struggling with how do we think about capturing some of these moments. And it goes back to where I was saying, just videotape it. And he was at a visit with some school children, and this one kid was acting up and drumming on a chair. So the prime minister sat down next to the kid and started drumming on the chair with him. It was 15 seconds, but they put that video up on Facebook, and it's one of their most watched videos. And it provides a glimpse into the prime minister, a more human side of him, the jokester side of him, that many people hadn't seen. In India as well, we've been working with the Ministry of Women and Child Development. They launched an initiative last week called 100 Women. They are, through Facebook, taking nominations from people for the next 2 months of people who want to nominate women in their lives impacted the community. The ministry then is going to take those submissions, and they've selected a jury and a judge of prominent people throughout India who are going to look at all the submissions and come up with the top 200. From there, they will go back to Facebook, and people on Facebook will then be able to vote on the 100 that should be able to go to an event with the president around Republic Day in January. And what they're doing to help encourage people to make these nominations is they are sharing video stories of women throughout the country who have made an impact. And these stories, whenever you can tell a story about somebody here in Brazil who has been impacted by the policies that you've enacted, or who has been changed by something that your ministry has done, the more powerful that can be on Facebook. And if it can be via video, that's great, but even photo or text can also work. With video as well, sometimes just direct to camera also works. Prime Minister David Cameron did this quite a bit during the recent UK elections and has continued doing it now that he's moving back into governing, where after he was visiting a factory or visiting with people throughout the country, he would do a very quick video explaining who it was that he had met with and what he had learned. He also did something as simple as a holiday message. So his most watched video was actually him wishing everybody a happy Easter. And so if you can think about ways to combine topics that we already know are talked about a lot on Facebook holidays with formats of content that we know work well, video, that's really great. And with video, we also give you video stats for you to be able to look at to know whether or not your videos are working. We will show you at what point in time do people drop off video, which is right here. We'll show you the average amount of time that people watch. On average, we're finding people are only watching about 15 seconds of video. Because remember, most of them are on their mobile device. So when you're thinking about the videos that you put up, you want to try to keep it at a minute or less. Now, if you need to post videos that are longer, you can. You can post up to 40 minutes on Facebook. But you might think about, rather than doing the full 40 minutes, doing them in shorter chunks so that people can better digest what it is that you're putting up on Facebook. We'll show you the number of video views that the video got. We count something as a view if they've watched after 3 seconds. And then we'll also show you how many people watched at least 95% of your video. This will just allow you to see and experiment with different video formats that you want to put up on your Facebook page to see what works best for your fans. I want to talk a little bit about how to measure success. I get a lot of questions from people about how do we know if what we're doing on Facebook is actually working. And so when you're looking at your insights, this is just an example of an insights dashboard. The number of fans you have is certainly important. However, the number I think that is most telling and most important is this post reach number, which is right here in the middle. That's the number of unique people over the last 7 days who have seen some of your content. And oftentimes, the best pages I'm seeing, even in politics, is that they are reaching far more people than the number of fans that they have. Because that means that you have a lot of people engaging with your content, and you have a lot of people who are seeing it, even if they might not be a fan. We also show you what time of day most of your fans are on Facebook. We find, on average, that most people are on Facebook between 9 and 10 o'clock at night. So we have heard anecdotally that shifting your posting strategy when you can to be later in the day sometimes help you to reach more people. That said, if something is breaking news or something is happening, please put it up on Facebook right away. And also look at your own graph. There are pages that I've seen that don't necessarily follow what we see that works across the board on Facebook. So look at your own graphs and see what times of the day are more of your fans on Facebook. Just because you might think that, okay, I'll do a post at 9 a.m. because that's what time I get into the office, but oftentimes very few people are on Facebook at that point in time. And because I know many people probably don't want to be working at 9 o'clock at night, if you aren't already familiar with it, we do have a way for you to schedule posts so that when you're doing a post on Facebook, you can. There's a button in the lower left-hand corner that looks like a clock. If you click on that, you are then able to set the date and time that you would like that post to go live. You can schedule posts as far out as 6 months in advance. However, I wouldn't recommend you do that. I recommend you do no more than 24 to 48 hours, just so you don't forget what you've had scheduled. And then for those pages that have over 5,000 fans, you can also target your posts organically. So you can target your posts if you would like to try different messages to your fans who are male versus female. Perhaps you want to try messages to different people in different age ranges. But the one I see used the most is the location targeting. This gives you the ability that if you're doing an event or something in a particular city and you want to post that just to your fans in that city, you can choose to do that through our targeting feature. And then on Insights, we also just allow you to see all your individual posts and see the performance of those. You're going to see the reach of individual posts fluctuate. It's dependent on a lot of different factors, what else is being happening on Facebook, what else people are talking about, etc. And so I recommend you use this list to see which of your posts are performing the best, what should you keep replicating, what might you want to change, and then use that 7-day post reach number that I was showing you in order to figure out whether your overall performance of your page and making sure that you continue to trend upward of the number of people who are seeing your content. So I want to just quickly go through some next steps, and then I'm happy to take any questions. If I can, there we go. So what my recommendations are for you leaving here today is, first, please go and check your security settings for your profiles. Please make sure that your profiles have all of our security features turned on to help prevent you from just losing access to your profile. Think about creating a conversation calendar. I've seen it really help a lot of people that if they take an hour or two, especially now if you know it's recess or it's not as busy, where you can look at the next 3 to 6 months, look at where the different holidays are, look at where there's different events, different highlights of what might be happening, and where are there opportunities where you might be able to do a video, where you might be able to take one of those behind-the-scenes photos, where you might be able to do a face-to-face. And think about scheduling, forgive me, it says schedule a Q&A, but here in Brazil we call it a face-to-face. Think about scheduling an opportunity to engage with your fans. Now, if a live chat makes you a little bit nervous as the first thing to do, that's okay. There's other ways to think about engaging with your fans. What some ministries do is they will put up a post asking people for questions, and then they will have their minister or another expert answer those questions in short video clips that they put up, you know, one or two a day to their fans. You can also just engage with fans just in, you know, every single day in the comment section if you want. I know some ministries that do this to share information about how to get visas or other information that they may be trying to get out to the public. If you haven't already, please try posting video directly to Facebook or thinking about how you might be able to try utilizing video on our platform. It's growing every single day, and it's something that we've seen really help change many pages and help them to get a lot more reach. And then finally, just make sure you're using the insights to measure success. You're going to have some weeks where your reach is up and some weeks where your reach is down. That's okay. You want to look at the overall trend lines for your reach to make sure that over the long haul that your trend lines are moving upward in terms of the number of people that you're reaching on a regular basis. But with that, I'm sure that there's somebody walking around with a microphone in order to take questions so that our awesome translators in the back can help me help translate your questions into English. And I just want to thank you all again for having us here today. We really appreciate it. And once we're done with Q&A, just so I don't forget, once we're done with Q&A, we're going to have a short coffee break over in this direction. And then my colleagues from our media and sales team will be coming up here to share with you a little bit more about how you might think about boosting some of the content that you're putting on Facebook.
Paquere, para ir respondendo as dúvidas, o pessoal que está com os microfones vão auxiliando vocês. Muito obrigado novamente pela presença.
I'm Leonardo, I work for the Ministry of Sport. And we have the Olympic Games next year, and one of the tools that we are testing now is Periscope. Do you have does Facebook have an idea or a plan to make something like that, leak transmission through Facebook, or to change face to face to make something like Hangout?
So on those questions about both live streaming and looking at doing being able to do video Q&As, there's a third party too. We're looking at everything. And I think what we're trying to do is trying to look at not only what, you know, how live video and video that's recorded and put up on Facebook, what are people engaging with more and what works the best? And I think where we're gonna end up moving to is a place where you're gonna need a strategy to think about how do you incorporate live video, how do you incorporate real-time video clips so that you do so in a way so that people have the opportunity to engage with you even if they can't at the moment that event is happening. A lot of times we see with live streams on Facebook that they don't necessarily have a ton of views exactly when that moment's happening. However, if you look at the 24-hour period afterwards, they get a lot of views and a lot of engagement. And so we're looking at everything. I don't have anything to announce today, but what I would say is when you're thinking about your strategy over the next year, I think you're gonna wanna think about the varying ways that you can use video, but also making sure that you're providing it in a way so that people can experience those, because you're gonna be on a global stage. You're gonna have people who are on the other side of the world and won't be able to watch that moment live when it happens, but you want it to be the first thing in their Facebook newsfeed when they wake up. I think about this weekend, did any of you see that video clip of the surfer who was attacked by the shark live on Facebook? That happened in South Africa, and for me, it was one of the first videos that I saw when I opened up my Facebook page, because it was something that a lot of people were talking about. That was something that was captured on live television, but then put up on Facebook for everybody to see. So I would just keep all that stuff in mind when it comes to video, and just keep an eye on the different things that we do announce, because we're looking at everything.
Hello.
Oh, okay, sorry, I gotta
light my Paula da Secom. Eu queria voltar à questão do algoritmo do Facebook. O desafio que a gente tem é entregar, né, para as pessoas que curtem as páginas de governo. E o que a gente tem visto é que quanto maior a página, né, quanto mais curtidas tiver, o alcance vai caindo. Então, mesmo a gente usando as melhores práticas que vocês recomendam, vídeos curtos, variar o tipo de post, eu queria entender um pouco mais. Por que que acontece isso? Quanto mais curtidas as páginas têm, menor tende a ser o alcance. Obrigada.
It's not necessarily dependent on the number of likes that you have. I see some pages that have millions of likes that have a huge amount of reach, just depending upon what is happening at that point in time. For instance, just to use the elections again, you know, all of the candidates had, you know, a couple million fans, but they were reaching far more number of people with their accounts. And the election is special, but I just wouldn't associate it necessarily with the number of fans you have. It goes back to that engagement and how much engagement that you are getting on your posts. But also just the truth of the matter is what we see is just that you're competing up against so much more content because there's the amount of content being created is going up exponentially. And so while there are numerous best practices that I gave you around how to do really great organic content, the videos, engaging with fans, you know, working with other pages. If you really want to make sure that you're guaranteeing that you reach the number of people that you want to, you may consider needing to think about doing a paid strategy with Joe and Marcio, we'll talk about here in a little bit. And that's some of the ways that we see governments when they know that we need to make sure we reach this number of people, they do end up needing to put a little bit of paid advertising behind it. But otherwise, it goes back to it's the pages that get the most engagement and are regularly posting and providing content that people do want to see. So I know it's hard. There's not a silver bullet in terms of do this type of content all the time, and I promise you, you'll reach everybody that you want to reach. It really requires a lot of testing, a lot of trying different content, figuring out what it is that your fans like to engage with. And then usually what happens is, you know, after some period of time, how your fans engage will change, so you'll need to change your content. But then you also need to think about, if possible, how can you work in a paid strategy, which João, and then we'll talk about here in a little bit.
Bom dia, Mariana, Portal Brasil da Secom também. Ainda na linha do que a Paula perguntou sobre engajamento, a página do Portal Brasil ela é receptiva das campanhas de mídia da Secom. Toda vez que a gente tem mídia, quando a mídia acaba, a gente tem uma queda brusca no engajamento. Então, a gente faz todo um trabalho, engajamento da página, com as pessoas que chegaram da última campanha, e quando entra uma campanha no ar, ela acaba, nosso engajamento cai de forma monstruosa. Não é um ciclo viciante ali, de você bota a mídia, cai o engajamento, quando você está retomando, coloca a mídia de novo, aí sobe, você tem que resgatar tudo aquilo de novo.
One thing that you will want to look at, absolutely, when you do turn off a paid media strategy, you are going to see your engagement go down. But oftentimes what we see, and I'll need my colleagues to correct me if I'm wrong here, but sometimes what we see is that the engagement level doesn't go down to the exact same level that it was before. Sometimes it might still be a little bit higher because you were able to get some of that engagement with those fans. But doing a paid media strategy, and you did a lot of engagement and a lot of reach, when you do stop that, we do expect it to go down a little bit. And then, so what sometimes people choose to do is they will, they choose to have some advertising running all the time to do some of their posts, and then they do larger portions of money for the big events that they want to make sure that they're advertising for. But I want to save those questions for my colleagues because they're going to be much better to answer those.
Raíssa da Embrapa. A gente faz a gestão de várias páginas da Embrapa que são geradas automaticamente pelo Facebook por meio do check-in que as pessoas fazem. Isso tem dificultado o nosso trabalho porque algumas páginas a gente consegue ser o gestor dela, outras pessoas já pegaram essa gestão. Então eu queria saber uma forma de não permitir ou de cancelar essas páginas geradas automaticamente pelo Facebook por meio do check-in.
Sure. So one thing, just first, if you are a page that you get a lot of people doing check-ins with, You might consider adding the address to your own Facebook page so that yours comes up when somebody wants to do a check-in. If you do see those other pages or pages that other people create, the best thing to do is Natalie, who's down here in the front row in the cream-colored blazer, who's raising her hand. The best thing to do, I'm giving her so much work today. The best thing to do is to please email her with the links to those pages that you didn't authorize or you aren't an admin of, and we'll take a look. We'll need to take a look to let you know what your options are for gaining access to those, but we can certainly try to help you to either see if we can merge them into your existing page or potentially take them down.
Bom dia, Kate.
Where are
aqui.
You?
No fundo.
Oh, thank you.
Bom dia. Meu nome é Renato e eu tenho duas perguntas. A primeira é: a frequência de publicação influencia na taxa de entrega, mesmo que eu tenha um alto engajamento? E a segunda pergunta é: a reputação de quem curte ou comenta as minhas publicações acaba influenciando na minha reputação ou não?
So on your first question, the frequency of posting I do see can sometimes affect it, especially if you're doing let's say 5 posts in 5 minutes. You don't necessarily want to do that, because I've seen some pages do that. For instance, we had somebody who did a Q&A, they asked for questions, and then they did 5 video clips, and they decided to put each video clip up as a separate post within 5 minutes. 4 of those clips got like 100,000 views each. The first one they put up had gotten like 500,000. Because what had happened was the algorithm had seen which one was getting the most engagement and then started showing that one more than the others. So in that instance, what I would have recommended was putting an hour or two between each of those posts so that you give it time to be out there. And you might even time it out a little bit further. So it can affect it if you're doing a lot of posts in a very short period of time. You want to think about spacing things out. Now, in terms of the importance of the person who's engaging on your content, if you get somebody with a lot of followers or a lot of fans sharing your content, that can absolutely affect it, because it's getting it out there in front of a lot more people, which then is going to affect your newsfeed algorithm score, because when they share it, they're going to get a lot more people to engage with it. But it comes back down to that engagement number. So it affects your importance in the newsfeed algorithm, just because that if somebody has a lot of fans, they're getting more people to see your content and potentially interact with it.
Bom dia, meu nome é Madeleine, eu sou assessora da FUNAI. E eu já tive alguns problemas porque nós trabalhamos com índios. E o Facebook eliminou algumas páginas nossas do Facebook, enfim, na nossa página ali, algumas fotos, porque os índios estavam pelados. Eu falei no Facebook, algumas fotos eu consegui que, em algumas páginas a gente conseguiu que as postagens voltassem com um elevado número ali de seguidores, enfim, de curtidas e tal, e outras não.
I'm sorry that you had that experience. With our content policies, we are trying to find the right balances between, as you can imagine, we don't want to allow all naked pictures to be on Facebook. And so we're trying to find the appropriate ways in being able to do this internationally. And so for many of those pictures, just because of the way our policies are currently, most likely would not be allowed to stay up especially if it's pictures of children. That's even particularly sensitive to us, and we want to make sure that we're erring on the side of caution of these types of pictures that are going up, versus trying to be more liberal. And so what I would recommend is, again, Bruno and Natalie, who are both here, if you could reach out to them with some of the images that you had, it's best for us to be able to take a look at that, be able to talk to our content policy teams, and then let you know so you have a better sense of what is or isn't allowed, so that going forward you're able to think through your content strategies. That's a little bit of background in terms of how we're trying to struggle with that and how we just want to make sure we're really keeping kids safe on the platform. And so sometimes that means that we need to disallow some images, even though they might have the best of intentions.
Meu nome é Fernando Galo, eu sou da Secom. E eu queria pedir para você falar, no caso dos posts patrocinados, como é que funciona o ciclo de alcance dele durante todo o impulsionamento, sobretudo no começo e no final. E no caso da comunicação de governo, quando é recomendável patrocinar um post ou não, e quais os prós e os contras de fazer um post patrocinado em comunicação de governo?
If you don't mind, I'm going to save that question for my colleagues to answer, because I think that they're the best ones in which to do that, and they might answer some of your questions in their presentation as well. So please hold, and if they don't, make sure you ask it afterwards. That might be a perfect time for me to introduce... Oh, one more. Okay.
Bom dia, sou Daniela, do Ministério da Previdência Social. Eu queria saber uma pergunta muito simples, uma coisa muito simples, mas no Facebook que seja de governo, com qual frequência se deve trocar a foto de capa e que tipo de imagem é recomendada para isso?
The cover photo, I think it's more important what the photo is than necessarily how often you're changing it. What I would recommend is for your cover photo, make sure it's something that ideally, if you can have people in it, that's the best, something that describes who or what your ministry is. I don't recommend having it just be your logo, for instance. What I've seen some ministries do is when they have certain events or initiatives happening, that cover photo represents that event or that initiative. So for instance, the Ministry of Sport, I'm sure you're going to be doing a lot of photos that are around the Olympics or a lot around your different sports figures that you might have. Other people might be doing more cultural events, and they might share that. For Social Security, you know, it may be a picture more of people who are getting help in terms of signing up for Social Security, or people who have been able to keep their home, or anything like that in terms of what you're doing. The best pictures, what I'm basically trying to say, are those that tell stories and those that really represent who your ministry is, rather than necessarily just the logo. With that, I'd like to introduce my colleagues Zhao and Marcio, who are going to talk to you about the media and paid advertising on Facebook. Thank you so much again.
Obrigado, Katie. Bom dia, pessoal. Vocês estavam tímidos antes, né, do coffee. Foi só tomar um cafezinho que as perguntas vieram. Eu vou apresentar alguns dados introdutórios e depois o Márcio também vai fazer uma apresentação para vocês, e a gente procura trazer um balanço entre toda uma ação orgânica, né, uma ação que aquele já está muito acostumado a fazer globalmente, aquele é a melhor pessoa do mundo para falar sobre governo, para falar sobre politics, né? E a gente pensou também nessa manhã em fazer um bem bolado, falar um pouquinho sobre essa parte orgânica, mas também trazer para vocês alguns conceitos, conhecimentos sobre o que é mídia dentro do Facebook, né? Como é que o Facebook consegue ser um canal de mídia? E a gente espera responder algumas das perguntas que vocês fizeram aqui ao longo da apresentação. Se a gente não responder ao longo da apresentação, a gente tem um espacinho também final para perguntas e respostas no finalzinho dessa manhã. Queria fazer alguns agradecimentos aqui. Primeiro, agradecer a Secom e parabenizar por esse evento, né? Ficamos super felizes de ser convidados para expor um pouco sobre o Facebook, para falar um pouco sobre o poder, o impacto que essa ferramenta tem e como vocês, aqui no governo, podem aproveitar melhor o Facebook para se comunicar com a sociedade, com a população, trabalhar a exposição dos seus programas, né, de tudo que vocês têm feito. Então, Kef, em nome, né, de toda a Secom, agradeço ao convite feito ao Facebook. Me apresentando, acho que algumas pessoas aqui me conhecem, eu não conheço a maioria de quem está aqui hoje cedo. O Facebook, como canal de mídia, como veículo de mídia, tem feito um trabalho bastante próximo do governo desde uns 2 anos e meio atrás, né? A gente tem 3 anos e meio de operação aqui no Brasil, a gente começou a ter uma frequência maior aqui em Brasília faz cerca de 2 anos e meio, e tem uma interlocução mais próxima com a Secom, com os órgãos, com Correios, Banco, Ministérios e etc. Eu sou hoje o diretor de negócios responsável pelo segmento de governo aqui no Facebook. Sou responsável por alguns outros segmentos também, e vocês vão conhecer mais para frente, não vou atrapalhar, mas o Márcio Freire é a pessoa de governo, é a pessoa que qualquer pessoa que aqui quiser fazer mídia no Facebook depois vai conversar, vai conhecer. vou deixar ele mais para frente. Eu queria só começar e fazer uma breve introdução sobre alguns conceitos básicos e dois pontos que eu acho que são muito importantes de vocês aqui terem em mente sempre que vocês pensarem em Facebook, né? Qualquer ação que vocês forem fazer no Facebook, o que é importante vocês pensarem? A primeira realidade é que o Facebook é uma ferramenta mobile, né? Mobile celular mesmo, smartphone, que todo mundo aqui tem no bolso, né? Já checou hoje de manhã? Quem checou o Facebook hoje de manhã? Levanta a mão. Né? A maioria. É, quem fez isso logo que acordou, antes até de levantar da cama? Quem fez check-in aqui no CCBB já? Olha, esses números são impressionantes, né? Facebook é uma plataforma móvel, né? A gente muitas vezes pensa no Facebook naquele site onde ele surgiu há um pouco mais de 10 anos em Harvard, mas cada vez mais a realidade do Facebook é uma realidade de um celular, né? De um mini computadorzinho que a gente carrega no nosso bolso, na nossa mão. E quando a gente pensa no Facebook como mídia, o que é mídia? É o tempo que você passa consumindo informação, conteúdo, etc. E o Facebook passa a ser um canal de mídia, né? Então, algumas realidades que eu quis trazer para vocês. A média de vezes que as pessoas acessam o celular por dia, isso são algumas pesquisas que foram feitas recentemente, é de 100 vezes. Quem acha que acessa mais de 100? O celular para tudo. Para que a gente acessa o celular? Para viver. Uau, Andréia foi profunda aqui. Olha, eu vou falar, eu uso para ver a hora, para que mais? Para ver o tempo, mapa. Para ligar, ninguém usa? Em média, a gente usa 100 vezes por dia. A gente pega no nosso celular, né, acessa o celular para fazer qualquer uma dessas atividades 100 vezes por dia. É, pensando em Facebook e Instagram, a média de vezes que as pessoas acessam o celular para ver Facebook ou Instagram é de 25 vezes por dia. Ou seja, uma em cada quatro vezes que a gente vai lá no nosso celular é para mexer no Facebook ou para mexer no Instagram. Se a gente olhar só para o Facebook, esse número está em 14. Ainda assim é um número muito alto, né? E ainda assim é um número que impressiona. Se a gente for pensar que a gente acorda às 8 e vai dormir umas 10, vai. E aí tudo bem, estou dando bastante horas de sono aqui, mas a gente é quase uma hora, uma vez a cada hora a gente está acessando o Facebook, né? É bastante frequente esse hábito. E o Brasil já é o sexto mercado mundial em número de smartphones, né? A gente tem o último dado que a gente tem de Marketeer de janeiro, e é um dado até que eu já fui questionado, tem gente que me falou que esse número já está acima dos 50 milhões, 60 milhões, é um número que vem crescendo, né? Isso é um dado de 6 meses atrás, obviamente está obsoleto, mas ainda assim, 39 milhões de brasileiros acessando os seus celulares num smartphone, a gente está falando de 1 a cada 5 brasileiros que estão acessando o smartphone, né? E aí, de novo, vem o crescimento do Facebook, vem alguns dados que a Kayleigh trouxe para vocês. Quando a gente fala de Brasil, são 94 milhões de brasileiros acessando o Facebook, 81 milhões estão acessando via dispositivos móveis. Ou seja, já é quase a totalidade. E a perspectiva que a gente tem é que o nosso crescimento está cada vez mais vindo de mobile, não está vindo de novos usuários de desktop, né? Então, vê que a gente está comparado, óbvio, a China é um gigante, né? Não dá nem para a gente se comparar. Mas estão aí muito próximos de Rússia, de Japão, que também são mercados super desenvolvidos e com muita gente. Então, pensem sempre, qualquer ação que vocês forem fazer organicamente, em termos de mídia, pensem no Facebook como uma plataforma mobile. Pensem como é que vai ficar aquela imagem, aquele conteúdo, aquela informação, aquele texto, aquele vídeo, numa telinha pequenininha das pessoas. E o que essas pessoas estão fazendo no Facebook, né? O fato de o Facebook ser uma plataforma mobile faz com que cada vez mais as pessoas usem o Facebook para postar sobre o que está acontecendo no mundo, né? Aquele deu o exemplo do tubarão que atacou lá o surfista. É, a gente está há poucos dias de um ano, né? Faltando para os Jogos Pan-Americanos do ano que vem. Isso aqui são alguns... Os Jogos Pan-Americanos não, Jogos Olímpicos, desculpa. Estou confuso aqui. Os Jogos Olímpicos do Rio de Janeiro, né? 5 de agosto de 2016. Daqui a algumas semanas a gente vai comemorar, né? Esse um ano. E o que a gente espera ver daqui a um ano é o que a gente viu há um ano e é o que a gente vê, talvez em menor escala ou em diferentes escalas, todos os dias no Facebook. As pessoas estão falando sobre o que está acontecendo lá fora, né? Então, se está tendo Copa, putz, aí entra lá no Facebook, você vai ver sobre Copa. Na época das eleições, a gente entrava no Facebook, só se falava sobre as eleições, sobre o candidato esse, a candidata aquele, só sobre isso. Esses são alguns números, até para mostrar um pouco de dimensão global, e a gente pode ir para esses aspectos mais específicos, né? Mas se a gente ligar no último capítulo da novela que está passando, você vai ver que tem gente comentando sobre o fulano, sobre o ciclano, sobre esse personagem ou aquele. Então é uma plataforma mobile, por ser mobile faz com que seja real time. E aí eu queria trazer algumas comparações aqui para vocês também. Como é que o Facebook se compara com outros canais de mídia, né? Quando a gente fala Facebook, não é só mídia social. Quando a gente fala que Facebook é uma mídia, né, e vocês podem usar o Facebook como mídia para acessar outras pessoas, como é que a gente se compara? O Facebook, com 94 milhões de usuários, de pessoas que acessam todos os dias, já é 11 vezes maior do que a circulação dos três principais jornais do país, né? O Globo, Folha e Estado, né? A gente tem uma possibilidade de chegar em pessoas que é significativamente maior do que esses jornais. E, de novo, a gente nunca vai fazer um desmerecimento, falar só o Facebook funciona, o jornal não presta, a revista é isso, a TV é aquilo. A gente acredita muito no mix e existem formas diferentes de você conseguir chegar na população e na sociedade. Não dá para desperdiçar ou desclassificar qualquer um, mas a gente tem que ter também conhecimento, né? Quando a gente às vezes tem aquele mindset, aquele pensamento de ah, é o Facebook, é uma mídia social, é pequenininho, é uma mídia de massa, né? É uma mídia de 94 milhões de brasileiros, é 1,5 vezes maior do que a penetração anual de televisão a cabo no país, é significativamente maior também do que certos portais, o UOL, Globo.com, Terra, né, que são os principais portais do país. É, e mesmo quando a gente faz uma comparação, né, e pega aquele uso do que a gente chama de second screen, né, quando a pessoa está vendo televisão e está com o celular. Quem costuma fazer isso? Ver televisão e está com o computador ou celular na mão. A gente nem sabe mais qual que é a primeira e qual que é a segunda tela, né? Às vezes a gente chama a segunda tela a da TV porque ela está mais longe, a minha atenção está aqui no meu celular. Mas o que a gente vê é isso. Quando a gente faz uma comparação até com alguns dos principais produtos, né, do principal canal de televisão, é, a gente já tem bastante gente comparativamente com o Jornal Nacional. A gente às vezes pode pensar em fazer um lançamento, uma grande comunicação. E de novo, falando sobre mídia, isso, né? Porque é, a gente quer chegar em escala e quer chegar em muita gente. 1,6 vezes o público que assiste ao Jornal Nacional, 1,3 vezes o público que assiste à novela 3. São dados históricos esses, não necessariamente dessa novela agora. É... E aí vem o segundo ponto que eu acho que é importante, que eu queria trazer para vocês. Quais são alguns dos players, né, das empresas públicas que já descobriram o poder da mídia no Facebook, né? Porque eu acho que Facebook, de fato, todo mundo aqui utiliza, tem a sua página, faz as suas comunicações. Eu queria trazer alguns exemplos aqui de campanhas que foram veiculadas, como campanha de Correios, campanha da Secom. E eu não vou entrar em todos os detalhes, né? Se você não for citado aqui, não se chateie. A ideia não é dar prêmio ou nada disso. A gente só quer citar alguns exemplos e algumas dessas pessoas estão aqui também para compartilhar. Embratur, Ministério do Turismo. E aí eu queria chegar no ponto que a Kelly mostrou na apresentação dela, que para a gente também é crucial, assim como o mobile, que é o vídeo. Cada vez mais o conteúdo consumido no Facebook tem sido consumido em forma de vídeo. Por quê? Porque o vídeo é super rico, o vídeo consegue te contar uma história, né? Ele te traz muito mais informação do que necessariamente só um post ou uma imagem. E de novo, não desmerecendo a imagem, não desmerecendo esse formato, mas cada vez mais a gente tem visto um crescimento de vídeo. Eu fiz uma comparação aqui de duas campanhas que aconteceram em momentos distintos, e até em dois momentos separados do Facebook, né? Isso aqui é quando a gente ainda não tinha um produto de vídeo robusto. O que a gente costumava fazer? Embedava um vídeo de um outro site, geralmente do YouTube, e passava para cá. Essa é a comparação entre um vídeo do YouTube e um vídeo nativo no Facebook. Daí a gente pode trazer outros aspectos de comparação que o Márcio vai entrar em mais detalhes, mas que tem a questão do autoplay, tem a questão da facilidade, da agilidade, né, daquele vídeo. Então, reforço a recomendação que a Kelly fez. Utilizem vídeo, façam vídeos, e façam vídeos com celular mesmo, aqueles vídeos de atrás dos bastidores, o que está acontecendo, chegando no ministério, chegando na empresa, um evento, alguma coisa que está acontecendo. Grava aqui mesmo e dá um pouco daquela... Alguém fez uma pergunta sobre live stream aqui. O vídeo no Facebook, ele pode funcionar praticamente como fosse um live stream, se você consegue ter essa agilidade e subir. E isso aqui tem funcionado super bem também para a mídia, né? A gente tem um mindset de mídia histórico, muito forte de televisão. E ótimo, excelente, porque a televisão de fato tem uma super força. Como que a gente pode pegar um pouco desse aprendizado de vídeo que a gente tem na televisão e passar para o Facebook? Então aqui alguns outros exemplos, exemplo da Secom também. E é a segunda realidade que eu queria reforçar para vocês e trazer alguns dados. Vídeo, 8 em cada 10 vídeos que são descobertos no Facebook, eles são descobertos na internet, são descobertos no Facebook, né? De novo, super canal para você descobrir o que está acontecendo no mundo, não só em termos de notícias, mas com vídeos também. Quais são os vídeos que as pessoas estão compartilhando, estão assistindo, o que está bombando, né? O que está rolando no mundo.
8 em cada 10 vídeos são descobertos no Facebook na internet, e o crescimento, a gente não tem dados ainda de 2015 para compartilhar com vocês, mas o crescimento que a gente viu na plataforma entre 2013 e 2014 foi de quase 4 vezes o número de pessoas postando e interagindo com vídeos. E hoje, como a Kiri falou, são 4 bilhões de visualizações por dia, né? Pensa que a gente tem 1,4 bilhão de pessoas, é como se a gente tivesse 3 vídeos visualizados por dia globalmente no Facebook. No Brasil, o último número que a gente tem é que 50% das pessoas que estão no Facebook, todos os dias, assistem a no mínimo um vídeo. Pode ser que você assista um pouco mais, um pouco menos, mas, em geral, metade das pessoas que acessam diariamente o Facebook estão interagindo e vendo pelo menos um vídeo. Então, essas duas realidades fortes, eu queria deixar um aperitivo para vocês de um produto que tem ganhado cada vez mais força, que aquele também falou, o foco não é falar sobre ele hoje, mas não podíamos deixar de citar também a força que o Instagram tem conseguido aqui no nosso país. Alguns dados globais de Instagram, né? O Instagram começou lá em 2010, faz 5 anos, é muito incrível pensar o quanto que esse produto cresceu e se desenvolveu, e hoje já são 300 milhões de pessoas no mundo inteiro acessando o Instagram. 300 milhões de pessoas no mundo inteiro não é 1,4 bi que a gente tem no Facebook, mas é um número gigante, é um número super representativo. E o mais interessante é que 70% desses 300 milhões de pessoas estão fora dos Estados Unidos, ou seja, não é um produto que funciona só lá. Alguém arrisca dizer qual que é a posição do Brasil em pessoas que acessam o Instagram?
Primeiro. Terceiro.
Terceiro. Quem acha que é menos, quem acha que é mais? Segundo, quarto. Estamos lá nos top 5, né? Estamos bem, pelo menos. A gente é o segundo país em pessoas dentro do Instagram globalmente. É, vimos um crescimento também em 2004 vertiginoso, né? 100% mais de pessoas. E o que é o Instagram que eu queria trazer para vocês principalmente? O Instagram é uma plataforma de conceitualização, né? De você colocar uma ideia e uma perspectiva por meio das imagens, né? Não por meio de banner, de texto, por meio de imagens. E podem ser imagens de foto, podem ser imagens de vídeo. 70 milhões é o número de imagens que são postadas no Instagram todos os dias, né? Então pensa que a gente tem 300 milhões de pessoas, 70 milhões todos os dias, é bastante gente colocando fotos e interagindo e seguindo, né? E existem alguns conceitos que eu não vou entrar em detalhes, mas o tipo de utilização que as pessoas fazem do Instagram é diferente do que elas fazem do Facebook, né? É uma outra plataforma mais conceitual, até artisticamente, visualmente interessante, né? Onde você vê, você quer ver coisas mais inspiracionais. Então, quero reforçar, é uma plataforma super poderosa e super eficiente também para vocês conseguirem fazer comunicação. E aí, dois pontos para deixar. Mobile é massa, pensem sempre nisso. Mobile não é que agora a gente vai fazer uma campanha de mobile de nicho para falar daquele aplicativozinho. Não, mobile é uma plataforma de massa. Eu vou falar com 81 milhões de brasileiros que estão acessando o Facebook via mobile e vídeo continua com muita força, né? Aquela história de que, ah, não, vídeo não existe mais, agora é tudo rápido, tem... Vídeo continua com muita força, são outros tipos de vídeo que a gente está fazendo, né? Outro approach que a gente faz. E com isso, a ideia que a gente tem agora, e eu vou chamar o Márcio Freire aqui ao palco, é que a gente traga para vocês um conteúdo super relevante e recente que a gente tem apresentado para o mercado, que é como é que a gente usa o Facebook para trabalhar branding, né? Então a gente fez um roadshow em algumas agências recentemente, né, no mercado, e a gente quis trazer em primeira mão aqui para o mercado maior alguns conceitos de como é que o Facebook pode ser encarado como uma mídia de awareness, né, de visibilidade, de criação de marca. Legal, obrigado. Volto depois para algumas perguntas e respostas. Agora é com o Márcio Freire.